This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
بعد عامين من الاحتلال قررت اثيوبيا سحب قواتها من الصومال ممهدة
After 2 years of occupation, Ethiopia decided to withdraw its forces from Somalia, paving the way for a new era. Somalia has suffered for nearly 2 decades from a devastating civil war. The withdrawal of the Ethiopian forces from Somalia may lead to a security and political vacuum, which in turn may lead to more bloodshed in the country. Meanwhile, the Al-Shabaab Mujahideen group said that they have captured the Somali city of Baidoa, where the headquarters of the Somali Transitional Parliament is.
It's the same chaotic scene that has been witnessed in Somalia for over 20 years. This news comes as the Somali capital of Mogadishu and the city of Baidoa are continuing to defy stability. This chaos is caused by a political vacuum, which has further exacerbated the security vacuum already witnessed in the country. Following the withdrawal of the Ethiopian forces from Somali cities, Somali opposition militias moved in and took control of military bases there. The armed militias took control of military bases which were previously under the control of the Ethiopian forces for nearly 2 years. They took control of military outposts in the Somali capital of Mogadishu and in the city of Baidoa, where the headquarters of the Somali Transitional Parliament is located. In the next few days, the African peacekeeping forces will likely engage in combat with armed fighters of the opposition. The security vacuum, which is the first variable in the equation of chaos in Somalia, is being further fueled by a political variable caused by the resignation of the Somali president, Abdallah Yusuf. Yusuf resigned after failing to oust his prime minister, Noor Hassan Hussein, whose government won the parliament's vote of confidence. Where are Somalis headed? A question that is very hard to answer, especially in the absence of a clear political map. If it happens, this stability could be Somalia's first experience since the collapse of the regime of Siad Barre in 1991. This news comes after the radical Asmara-based opposition alliance vowed to continue what it described as an armed jihad towards the creation of an Islamic state, even after the withdrawal of the Ethiopian forces from Somali soil. Sheikh Sharif, who is being described as a moderate leader in the Alliance for the Reliberation of Somalia, which signed the Djibouti Peace Accord, doesn't enjoy the support of the Eritrea-based opposition faction led by Tahir Owais. The nomination of Sheikh Sharif Sheikh Ahmad was the outcome of a power-sharing deal, a deal that helped bring Sharif back to Somalia after spending 2 years on the run. The rivals inside the opposition, with its two factions, Asmara and Djibouti, seem to not be able to exceed their ideological disagreement. This news comes after the Djibouti-based faction accused Eritrea of inciting the opposition in order to keep the fighting on Somali soil.
Some Mideast experts, and the greatest crisis facing Israel is not the threat from Hamas or Hezbollah or even Iran for that matter. It's the dire lack of water made worse by a record drought this month, as IBA's Aaron Viner reports.
Water authority officials are now predicting a 100 million cubic meter differential between the water supply and the demands of the public this year. Prime Minister Ehud Olmert ordered the authority to come up with yet another emergency plan to address the nation's water crisis following yesterday's cabinet briefing from National Infrastructure Minister Binyamin Ben-Eliezer. Despite desalination projects and efforts to conserve the precious resource through reduced gardening and the 100 million cubic meter water reduction from the agricultural sector, Israel's water shortage remains critical. January's unprecedented lack of rainfall was the worst in recorded history. Charts show that while the median level of rainfall into the Sea of Galilee from 1980 to 2007 was some 328 million cubic meters per year, Israel is expecting only 45 MCMs over the 2008-2009 season. In fact, Water Authority Chief Professor Uri Shani said that there was a zero probability that this drought year could have followed the four dry years that preceded it, yet it did. Water Authority spokesman Uri Shore said that the nation must internalize that, quote, there just isn't any water, and that the Israeli public, which uses a relatively large amount of the precious liquid, must reduce its demand even further. Meanwhile, the authority has no plans to ration water, unlike Israel's equally parched neighbor Jordan, which has already placed severe limits on household usage.
Palestinian factions exchanged statements from Damascus to Cairo reflecting the internal division. In Egypt, negotiations continued towards establishing a ceasefire. Fatah affirmed the importance of achieving a national unity government to solve all the unresolved problems. In Syria, however, several Palestinian factions doubted the legitimacy of President Mahmoud Abbas.
The debate over the organization of the Palestinian House is still heated. With the latest political polarization, Fatah affirmed the importance of forming a national unity government recognized by the international community to supervise the rebuilding of Gaza and monitor the border crossings. According to Fatah, the main reference to this sought-after government is the Palestinian Liberation Organization. However, Palestinian factions headed by Hamas said that the PLO is absent or invisible and that they were looking into building a national Palestinian council.
Our victory as a Palestinian people and a resistance in Gaza in the face of the Zionist offensive pushes us to develop the mechanisms of our national work. Since the PLO is absent or invisible, we aim to discuss in this and later meetings how to organize our internal Palestinian house and how to build a national Palestinian council.
Azam al-Ahmad headed the Fatah delegation in the Cairo talks on the national dialogue. He said that it was important to guarantee that the international community will not boycott the next Palestinian government. He denied the accusation that Fatah was trying to politicize the process of rebuilding Gaza, pointing to having discussed some unresolved issues with Kamal Abu Hashim, a Hamas top official.
They used to think mistakenly that we, Fatah, will take advantage of the offensive on Gaza and devour the authority. What authority? That's why we remained silent until the offensive ended, and then we began to discuss this issue. A little while ago, I discussed this with Jamal Abu Hashim. I told him that this kind of talk was dangerous.
Ahmad Jibril, the Secretary General for the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, the General Command, had another perspective. He spoke of what he described to be a conspiracy aimed at setting conditions that the factions will reject.
The legitimacy of Abu Mazen is over. We call him the former president. We no longer recognize him as president of the Palestinian Authority. As for him kidnapping the PLO and the Fatah organizations, these are issues that we will discuss at a later stage.
Fatah announced its desire to end the current Palestinian division in response to the priority of aiding and rebuilding Gaza. Meanwhile, Hamas and other factions decided to wait for the results of the National Reconciliation Initiative in Cairo before announcing their final decision.
Egypt kept the Rafah crossing open so that injured Palestinians could receive medical treatment in Egyptian hospitals. The injured were transported to the Al Arish hospital for medical treatment.
Vehicles transporting aid to and from Gaza have not stopped. About 340 tons of aid from the national ruling party in Egypt were sent to the Palestinian people in Gaza.
The movement of the traffic through the Rafah crossing has not stopped. Every day, injured Palestinians pass through the crossing. Among those who pass through the crossing are the head of the Egyptian Journalists Guild and the Secretary General of the International Journalists Union.
Israel has set a serious precedent of targeting journalists.
Israel has set a serious precedent of targeting journalists, and this is unacceptable. We are going to Gaza to support the journalists there and make sure that this does not happen again.
We'll make sure that it never happens again.
Israel has done to the journalists what no one else has done. Despite objections, Israeli practices against Palestinian journalists in the last 10 years has continued. The latest aggression against Palestinian journalists in Gaza, leading to the death of many of them, means that Israeli crimes have increased, requiring a serious investigation. Going to the International Court of Justice is also necessary.
Also present at the Rafah crossing are the UN envoys.
The effects of war on children is worrisome. We are trying to establish centers for the children so we can keep them away from the violence. We have distributed boxes of school materials to the children so they can keep up with their schoolwork. We also distributed chlorine so that the water will be safe to drink.
First of all, we would like to reaffirm our support of the resistance and its legal legitimacy as long as the occupation exists. We need to support our Palestinian brothers, and we have always been supportive of them. The Egyptians were bothered because they thought that the Rafah crossing was closed. Now we understand that the crossing was not closed. There is a massive confusion between opening the borders versus opening the crossing point.
Vehicles transporting aid have also not stopped. 340 tons of aid from the National Ruling Party in Egypt was sent to Gaza within an ongoing campaign to rescue the Palestinian people there.
I would like to give you a simple example. One lady contributed 5 kilograms of sugar to help the people in Gaza. All of these kinds of support come through our party offices, which were established in each village. We have about 350 party offices in Asiut. All party offices participated. The party has an operation room where young people help to package the supplies. Some are in charge of food supplies, while others are in charge of medical supplies.
The Rafah crossing remains open, with the hope that the political arrangements in the future will lead to an end of the siege on Gaza completely.
Live footage shows the monstrous Israeli violence that was inflicted on Gaza with ongoing shellings, killings, and destruction for 3 weeks. These true stories are told by the orphans, the bereaved mothers, and those displaced in the cold winter.
We did not anticipate having so much trouble observing what the war left behind in this area. Here where I am standing was a three-story home that is no longer a home to any memories of its residents. Over there is a mosque that was targeted and whose sanctity was violated. Between both of these scenes, this is the most painful to see.
هاي هذا منزلنا زي ما انتم شايفين اجوا كانوا يعني كان في قلبه شهداء اجوا اليهود ونسفوه
This used to be our house. There were martyrs in this house. Then the Israelis came and demolished it in order to hide their crimes. My mother, my father, my uncles, my older brother, my nephews, my cousins, and my whole family were among those who were martyred in this house. I don't have a life. How can I bring back my mother and father? They were all martyred, and my whole life has become full of pain and misery. Tell me, how can I bring my mother and father back? We only rely on God the Great.
Zainab al-Samouni was a child who witnessed a massacre of 29 members of her family. The occupying military killed them with shellings, executions, and leaving them to bleed to death. These children are left with the sadness of losing their parents, siblings, and other relatives.
I injured my head. Every time I put a pillow under my head, it gets drenched with blood. I think I used 15 pillows and they were all drenched. At the end, I brought a blanket and wrapped it on my head. Then the bleeding stopped, thank God. My brother Yaqub was injured in his heart. The wound was big enough to fit a cup. I tried to keep him on his back so that he wouldn't bleed to death. My brother Itzhak bled for 2 days and then he died.
The scenes of war and annihilation in the Alil Sumuni area, which these children witnessed, have robbed them of their childhood at a young age. This lady is from the Alil Sumuni family. Her 9-month-old baby, Mutasim, was killed by the bullets of a sniper that tore his fragile body apart and left his mother with a broken heart.
When I came here yesterday and saw our house, I began to cry because I remembered my husband and my baby. It was a devastating feeling. There's nothing good left in this world. I wish I could be martyred like all the others who were martyred.
The family that remains in the area is still in shock over what's happened, while others are still inspecting the rubble and searching for something that reminds them of those who died. This little girl was trying to be strong and keep herself from crying, but she broke down when we began talking about her father and her siblings who were killed in front of her.
They fired 3 rockets at our house. My family was martyred, which includes my mother, my siblings, my uncle, and my nephew. About 25 of my family members were martyred. I found my mother and sisters martyred. We went out and walked for about 2 kilometers. The injured were crawling on the ground, and they died while on the way.
This is a typical pattern of dozens of Palestinians who find themselves between the siege and the aggression. The new refugees hope that their cause does not get blown away with the wind, considering the bitter life that they were subjected to.
A tent does not prevent us from getting cold, only a house does. This house used to prevent us from getting cold. We were raised in this house and lived in it in peace. We came to find the house destroyed and our children martyred. It is too much. We want to live like the rest of the world.
With every minute that passes by, the Palestinians ask themselves, what was the crime they committed to deserve the killing of their families and the displacement of their children?
في هذه الأثناء رفعت لجنة من مجموعة محامين دوليين و350 منظمة حقوقية.
A committee of international lawyers and 350 human rights organizations have filed a lawsuit at the International Criminal Court to look into the war crimes that the Israeli military committed during its violent attacks on Gaza. The committee stated that the International Court will send a number of international professionals to the Gaza Strip to investigate the Israeli war crimes.
A group of international lawyers, a multinational jury, 350 human rights organizations, and a committee of activists met in Geneva to prepare the lawsuit. There they reached a conclusion regarding the lawsuit that was filed for the war crimes in Gaza. This lawsuit has gained official support from several countries such as Venezuela, Bolivia, and South Africa. The Palestinian Authority also joined by sending the Minister of Justice to The Hague. He observed from a distance the developments of the lawsuit filed to the Attorney General of the International Criminal Court.
Before the conference, I met with the Palestinian Minister of Justice. He prepared and organized everything in an excellent manner.
The lawsuit officially included the Palestinian Authority, despite the fact that the lawsuit was submitted by non-governmental organizations. According to diplomatic sources in Brussels, it was said that the Palestinian Authority did not act until they received humanitarian calls from Arab and European countries. The Palestinian Authority's lawsuit, which was filed at the International Court, is not the first, nor will it be the last one since the beginning of the Israeli war on Gaza. It will, however, gain legal legitimacy, which is not any less than the legitimacy of the lawsuits that were submitted by Venezuela and Bolivia, who are members of the International Court. Some concerned members proposed severe questions such as, where was the Palestinian Authority and what was it waiting for during the long weeks of the Israeli war on Gaza, in which war crimes took place? These sincere questions were asked before the Palestinian Authority joined in filing the lawsuit. This explains why the organizers had reservations about publishing the details of the lawsuit. They feared that they would be subjected to international pressure and face social criticism.
وهو ما أثار خشية المراقبين أيضا. لا أعتقد أن السلطة الفلسطينية قادرة.
I don't think that the Palestinian Authority can go very far with this lawsuit. This is what happened when Yasser Arafat, when he decided to file a lawsuit against Israel because of the massacres they committed in Jenin. There was a lot of international pressure on Arafat. They told him, if you file a lawsuit, then you will have to have many discussions and negotiations with Israel, which will be very hard. This is what will happen to Abbas and his group.
Even though the Israeli entity is not a member of the International Court, Israeli officials can be tried according to international law.
In the occupied Palestinian territories, the Palestinian foreign minister said that Israel's decision to grant its soldiers complete immunity from the consequences of its attacks on the Gaza Strip does not prevent a criminal investigation to be held. For her part, the Israeli foreign minister and the head of the ruling Kadima party, Tzipi Livni, expressed her support to form a national unity government in Israel after the elections, which are set to take place on February 10th.
The battle for the reconstruction of Gaza is happening on both the political level and on the ground. The scene has compelled the world to look at the extent of misery caused by the savage destruction of the occupation, with its demolition of homes and schools, which were places of refuge for the displaced. Tens of thousands of people have no shelter. It is a reality that horrified the European envoy for development affairs during his tour of the untouched catastrophic areas.
It is an amazing situation that cannot be described and exceeds our imagination. We must work fast, first to provide shelter for the refugees, and then reconstruction, which requires ensuring that the ceasefire holds, completely opening the crossings, and ensuring internal Palestinian reconciliation.
Before this, Michelle listened to the Palestinian Authority's position, which called for the return to national unity as the basis for reconstruction.
The most essential issue is to return immediately to national unity so as to maintain our objectives politically and nationally. Meanwhile, also being able to deal with the demands of this phase, which requires our immediate response to citizens' needs in the Gaza Strip.
The afflicted citizens in the Gaza Strip raise the banner of unity, which calls upon those political forces that are not directly involved in the internal conflict.
For the foundation of national unity, there needs to be Arab and international support. For the foundation of national unity, we must be able to confront the occupation and face it together.
The occupation has its eyes on the Palestinians. According to the Minister of the Army, Israel has again been hinting at restarting its war machine under the pretext that the Gazan Palestinians have continued to use the underground tunnels. It insists on placing impossible conditions for the ceasefire to hold. Thus, Israel is linking the issue of opening the crossings to releasing the Israeli captive Gilad Shalit. The European Union joined the appeal made by the Arab Summit and the continued appeal by the Palestinian public to take immediate measures for national reconciliation. So, what are the factions waiting for? From the Palestinian territories, Abdel Karim Samara, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia TV.
one reason Israel gave for its Gaza offensive was to destroy the tunnels running under the border with Egypt, which it says are used to smuggle weapons. Now, barely a week after Israel troops pulled out of the strip, many of those tunnels are already open again. Mike Kirsch went underground in Gaza and sent this report.
Bombed out of business by Israel just weeks ago were hundreds of tunnels it claims Hamas was using to smuggle weapons into the Gaza Strip. Now, after only a week since a ceasefire here, and despite Israeli threats to bomb operating tunnels again, at least a few are already up and running again.
They destroyed my tunnel, but do they think I'm going to sit at home and do nothing? I have kids at home that need money for school. This is my only source of income.
It's the first day since the war that Abu Assam's tunnel is bringing in goods. He spent $90,000 building it along with eight partners, finishing just 1 week before the war began. He has already brought in a wide range of items today, from generators to computers to ice cream sticks. Our Al Jazeera television crew was invited down below by another private businessman who runs this hole-in-the-ground operation. We were dropped 20 vertical meters below the Earth's surface. The tunnel runs 800 horizontal meters from South Gaza into Egypt. There are about 12 men that work down below, making final repairs to the damage sustained during the bombing. They're aware of the dangers posed by the shifting earth still settling above them from recent airstrikes.
Hey, what is this? This is a telephone line?
Telephone. This is a light.
This is electric?
Yes.
Okay, and you've got some pretty dangerous conditions here. You've got no support, no beams up above or on the sides of you. This could collapse on top of you. You've got soil here that comes right off. It's very moist soil. Yeah.
More tunnels like this will be going online in the coming weeks. Workers here claim that they have no choice but to rely on the tunnels because of Israel's embargo and naval blockade.
My message to the Israelis is that it's better for them to open the borders, because if they don't, then the violence will increase here and negative reactions will increase against them as well.
These men say that this is one of the few tunnels that has not been destroyed by Israeli airstrikes. When I asked them if they're concerned that it may be taken out in the future, they basically say no, inshallah, it won't. Mike Kirsch, Al Jazeera, under the Gaza Strip.
Meanwhile, the British Broadcasting Corporation, the BBC, is facing harsh criticism after refusing to broadcast an emergency fundraising appeal for aid efforts in Gaza. The BBC executives say they made the decision to protect the impartiality of their stance. More now from Press TV's Resham Mamatsong.
The British Broadcasting Corporation has provoked outrage by refusing to screen a charity advert for the victims of the Gaza conflict. Members of a British anti-war group briefly occupied the Glasgow offices of the BBC in protest at the decision. The two-hour occupation followed criticism from lawmakers and religious leaders, who said the decision was heartless and taken under pressure from the Israelis.
I'm appalled, and I will never work for the BBC again if this continues. I just think it's disgusting. I'm appalled, so appalled. It's a public service. People have the right to raise money in this way on the television for people that are in need. It's not a political thing.
Meanwhile, over 50 British MPs, including government ministers, are backing a parliamentary petition urging the BBC to run the advert by the Disasters Emergency Committee, a coalition of respected British charities. The petition seems to reflect the weight of public opinion.
I think they've damaged themselves by not showing the aid programme yesterday, and that's what a lot of people here are here for today.
I've been to Palestine myself, and that makes a big difference to anyone's attitude. And I find, of course, the BBC at the moment is the leader in that slant.
The BBC says it's concerned that showing the advert might harm its reputation for impartiality. It's also unsure the money raised will reach those in need. Other British broadcasters have said they will show the advertisement, but Sky News has joined the BBC in refusing to broadcast the emergency fundraising appeal.
The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.